everybody. Thank you for being here watching this Star Wars special on the Beyond Stuff channel. My name is Bryan Chivere, and I'm accompanied back again with Luis Vazquez. How you doing, Luis?
I'm doing great, you know, happy to be here.
Yeah, I've been trying to work this out. If you guys saw, I've been trying to figure out some mic issues. And you might be wondering why this episode didn't make it on Tuesday. So it's really funny. So a few days ago, I disconnected all the USBs from the computer. And then when I connected it, when I was figuring out the scene montages and everything for the special, I forgot to put the microphone into the system. So most of the episode, me ranting about Star Wars and Rise of Skywalker, I sound like. And now when I figure it out, now it sounds great. So hopefully this goes well. We're just starting. I'm not a professional at this. I'm just doing my best. So, how have you been in the last few days? You know, how have you been, Luis?
Been doing great. You know, doing exercise. You know, practicing my French. So, I've been good, and I'm really excited for tomorrow for the third season of The Chilling Adventures of Sabrina.
I saw like the first season. And the very first episode of the second season, I never got in back to it again. And I'm gonna be honest, the only reason I watched that show is because of Michelle Rodriguez. She played Missy on Doctor Who, aka The Master. And she was fantastic. I was a little bit bummed with the newest season of Doctor Who that they recasted The Master with Sacha. I don't remember his last name, so he's great as The Master, but Michelle Rodriguez, you see her on Doctor Who and you see her on Sabrina. Class act. But we're not here to talk about witches and bitches. We're here to talk about the other bitches in Star Wars. See, it's a universally loved franchise, 40 years and strong. We've seen a lot of comics, a lot of books, and a lot of TV shows. But one of the latest additions to the Star Wars story has been The Mandalorian. You see, The Mandalorian, created by Jon Favreau and produced by Jon Favreau and Dave Filoni, who you may know from The Clone Wars and Rebels. They made a great job with this show and involving class act talents like Taika Waititi, Deborah Chow. It only goes to show that these guys are serious into making good Star Wars TV content, especially for the Disney Plus streaming service, which, let's be honest, they're gonna be more Mandalorian and even more, not just the Mandalorian, and many more stories in the Star Wars universe. But Mandalorian goes to show that you can make it work on TV, something that they were afraid to do on ABC, which I don't think it would have worked on ABC. It's perfect for the Disney Plus series. Now, you guys saw me review it, the first episode of The Mandalorian. And let me tell you, I loved it. This is the best thing that has happened to Star Wars. And I think everyone can agree. Do you agree with that statement, Luis?
It's one of the best things that has happened to Star Wars, because this is what Star Wars should feel like, you know, a spaghetti western. We got a character who's completely mysterious, you know, who he wants, what he wants, and, you know, throughout the episode, you can see an interesting story arc. Yeah. You know, it's sort of like, you know, Clint Eastwood in The Good, the Bad, the Ugly, about caring about nobody, then maybe caring about somebody else, you know, and it's entertaining as hell, and it has one killer soundtrack. I really love the opening, the opening theme of the series.
I listen to that every day on my way to work, after wrapping up the shift, even when I'm here alone and it's a little bit too quiet, I put in the main theme for The Mandalorian, and Ludwig did a very great job doing that score. Not only that, it goes to show that this is great because the writing has been good. Baby Yoda, he's cute. He went freaking viral. There's not one day that I scroll through Facebook or Twitter without seeing Baby Yoda. And I love that little kid. And not only that, but just because it's TV, It does feel like Star Wars, you know, because when you, once you're on TV, the budget is not as compared to a theatrical budget. And once I saw from the get-go, it feels Star Wars. Not only that, the references to the overall universe, the familiar places, the creatures, it is a hit for Disney Plus. And now with season two coming up, and I've heard there's many characters from the Skywalker saga that are going to appear in the season two of The Mandalorian. Do you think that this thing has legs for, let's say, just as much as many seasons as Game of Thrones?
I hope that it doesn't end like the way Game of Thrones ended, but yeah, I think it has a shot of making other upcoming seasons because the first one is like, wow, super great. And the way it ended the first one, you're like, whoa.
Yeah. I love that. I love that ending and that big. I usually don't like cliffhangers. I hate them. But after such a fantastic journey throughout this season and watching that end shot with Giancarlo Esposito's Moff Gideon having the Darksaber, it was a great shot. And it's very smart to end in that shot because not only it is a fantastic way to end a great season, but it gives you more reasons to stay on Disney Plus now that they have the complete Clone Wars series and they have Rebels. If you want to know what the hell is the deal with this Darksaber, you can just go to and watch those cartoons. Yeah, they're cartoons, but guess what? They're connected and you can see it on The Mandalorian. Now, what do you expect to see on season two of The Mandalorian?
I expect like more action. Obviously, the main antagonist of the first movie to at least have like a gun fist battle with the Mandalorian. I would really love to see the to visit new worlds.
New
That
worlds, yeah.
I would like to see that. Yeah.
What I would like to see in on the next season of The Mandalorian, not just new planets and new worlds. I would like them to explore planets that have been visited in the sequel trilogy. Not just the planets that we've seen, like, Coruscant, Naboo. I had enough of them. Yeah, they're great planets and that is familiar with the fans, but. Let's get into more into the sequel trilogy too, to have those connections between those two trilogies. And I really want to see more of the of this quiet build up episodes like the last one. I want them to go start off like the last episode and then go on and increase the action and give me more story of how Mando grow up in the Mandalorian culture. Not just that. I want them to be longer because that's one of the things that bother me. Not only the episode where they went to Tatooine. No, that was bad, but the one thing that bothered me is they're 30 minutes long, and once you're in the Star Wars world, you want to stay in for as long as you can. Do you think they have to increase the runtime for these episodes?
I think they should be longer, like Game of Thrones, like each episode is at least an hour long, so I think with the budget that they have, they can make it into an hour longer, and it should be because you got so much in so little time, so yeah, why
Yeah, and
not?
it's Disney. They have money to spend. I mean, come on, have you seen the records they are breaking? They have money
Yeah.
to spend and more. And not just that. Hey, just use Doctor Who as an example. They start with a 60-minute episode and then they go to a 50 episode throughout the series. Do that. Doctor Who is a lesser show in terms of quality, and I love Doctor Who. And Mandalorian is great so far. So you can just take that from Doctor Who, 50-minute episode with a 60-minute episode opening. Maybe just keep the amount of episodes, just 8 episodes short. I think that's fair. And we'll see. I trust Disney, and especially I trust Favreau and Dave Filoni on it. Oh, sorry, on anything, because Dave Filoni has proven himself with the shows, and despite his 2 episodes being so and so when it comes to directing, this is his first exposure to live action, and for a first time live action director, I think it worked out fine. The second episode, eh, but the first episode, great introduction to this world. Now, The Mandalorian. We agree it is universally loved by every single fan. The Force Awakens as well. The Last Jedi, I think is good. But
I
it's
think it's solid, yeah.
yeah, but it is divisive, as you know. But I think J.J. Abrams did a great job with The Rise of Skywalker, uniting every single fan into loving the closing of the whole saga. But guess what? Not. It is not good. Sorry. It's not good. It's not.
It's like, you know what? At least
This is
let
what
the
I
good
told my.
people.
This is what I told to my coworkers once I, because I saw it on a day that I had to go to work, and I told them, listen, Star Wars. I love Star Wars. And The Rise of Skywalker is not bad. It's not bad, but it's not good either, because it has its moments. The adventure between the three new leads on the Star Wars franchise is great. Rey as a Palpatine, not great. What do you think about the movie? Did you hate it? Okay, did you dislike it as much as I do? Because hate is such a strong word, so.
Yeah, like I mentioned before, I'm like, yeah, I do agree that Rise of Skywalker is the weakest of the new
Oh,
trilogy because,
certainly.
yeah, because the issue is too much nostalgia. And J.J. Abrams, you know, I love him, and he's a nostalgic director, and I expected that. And, you know, many people were saying, like, Force Awakens being like a New Hope 2.0, which. Yeah, The Last I Read, but still, it's a great movie. It's one of my favorite Star Wars movies. But.
The reason I'm not that harsh with The Force Awakens, it's because that is exactly the direction that you needed to go after the prequels. I mean,
Yeah, exactly.
you see the hatred that the films have had for over the years. Now it's a little lesser than before, but in order to gain the trust of Star Wars, you had to go to the familiar route, you know?
Yeah.
And that's why I forgive as much with The Force Awakens, but I cannot forgive as much with The Rise of Skywalker.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. When I saw the throne room, you know, from the second Death Star, I'm like, oh my God, it survived the explosion?
No,
Really?
I'm surprised that much of the Death Star survived after having it seen on screen blow up into pieces. It's nearly as many pieces as when everyone in Infinity War was dusting off, just like that. And somehow we see this mad the whole throne room, the hallways and all. How? I don't know. Plots. Who knows?
Yeah, and then
And
they
it's
bring
not.
Palpatine back.
Yeah, and it's not. Listen, the visuals of the Death Star in the in underwater, they're great. But why? Yeah.
Yeah, it's like, why bring Palpatine back?
Exactly.
When I heard that news, I'm like, okay, it's only logical of the two things. Either it's a Force Ghost or flashbacks. And no, it's like the guy was a clone. I'm like, and what the hell was he doing in the last 30 years? And why bring it now? Like, I would more or less accept it if they bring back in the Force Awakens, but no, in the final movie of the trilogy, and that Snoke was Palpatine the entire time. No, I'm sorry, I'm not buying this.
Maybe
And.
building it up throughout The Force Awakens and the Last Jedi, maybe could have worked. But they didn't even do that. I mean, if you see The Last Jedi, they were building up to have Kylo Ren as the main antagonist, which is
Tigris.
what I wanted to see ever since I saw The Force Awakens. Yeah, he's a whiny kid, but he's a kid that he's conflicted with the light and the dark. And sometimes within this internal battle, you can go mad with that. And I wanted to see Kylo Ren go mad and fight
Yeah.
Rey to the end. And I thought we were going to go that way. And apparently, with the Colin Trevorrow's leaked script, that's the way we were going to go. What happened? The Last Jedi happened, and many people hated it. I thought it was great because it was different. But they
Yes.
went into the familiar. And again, visiting some of the planets was fine. Revisiting some of the characters are fine. But you basically threw up the things that you saw in the originals,
That literally, yeah, it's like,
and
yeah.
you went into Reddit and see how do I do this and how do I interconnect this with that without making any sense, and there's your script. And for if it is, and I'm not hating it because again, I have the same relationship that I have with the prequels. Yeah, they're bad, but I can watch them a lot. Well, saving Attack of the Clones, that movie is dreadful. But I can watch The Rise of Skywalker, but I cannot love it as much as I love the originals, and as much as I love The Force Awakens, and as much as I love The Last Jedi. And it saddens me because, again, there was a great build-up with the Last Jedi. Rian Johnson gave you a pathway to make something new with a 40-year-old franchise, and you go around and do same old, same old. Palpatine is back, completely ruining Darth Vader's redemption arc. Why?
Yeah. Also, I think personally that trilogy overall, I feel would be better if J.J. Abrams would have directed all three movies because he did the setup, yeah, similar. Then Ryan Johnson with The Last Jedi, it's not bad. The standalone movie is good,
Yeah,
but
I
he just
can't,
went
yeah.
into a completely different direction, and then came J.J. back. I know, let's go to this other.
And
It's like,
that's what
oh,
I
okay.
liked about the Rian Johnson movie, because he went to another direction. Again, Canto Bight, that's undefensible. Benicio del Toro, wasted.
Wasted talent.
But I admire that Rian Johnson tried to do something new with the franchise, because that's what you need to do. It's okay to be in a familiar setting. Again, The Mandalorian, but you're telling a brand new story with a brand new character. But enough about the negatives of this movie. I want to talk about the positives of this movie too.
Yeah.
I think the acting between Adam Driver and Daisy Ridley, brilliant.
Great.
It was brilliant. Adam Driver, God, he's gonna be like the actor of the decade this decade. I'm telling you that now. The supporting cast, fantastic. I hated that they wasted Kelly Marie Tran, and I know that's because they gave in to the hate to the hatred of the fan base. But
Yeah.
again, with the little scenes that she had, I was fine with it. The new additions to the cast too. Kerry Russell what had no reason to be in that movie. Sorry, Bliss, but I liked it. I liked the character. Babu Freak. Who doesn't love Babu Freak?
Yeah.
The scene between Luke and Rey in Act Two, it was a fantastic scene.
Yeah.
Carrie Fisher, the lines were cringy, but that last sequence when she was reaching out to Ben, it touched my heart. And I'm one of the guys that hated the fact that there was a redemption arc coming for Kylo Ren slash Ben Solo. But how you build up to it, her reaching out to him, and then seeing the memory of Han Solo. It was a charming moment. Yeah, could have been better, yes. But it was touching, at least to me. And of course, Billy coming back as Lando Calrissian. I love every single minute I had with him. Now, going off and ending this Rise of Skywalker thing, there's a lot of things to be expected, like the second season of The Mandalorian. We have the Obi-Wan series. We have the Cassian Andor from Rogue One. And
yeah.
we also have the Clone Wars coming up next February, which I think I will not have time to catch up. And there's a couple of more shows in development, as well as the High Republic. Apparently, a High Republic film taking place before the events of this of the saga, featuring a young Yoda as a Jedi and all that. Do you think the future of Star Wars is safer on TV, or they should throw themselves and try something new in the theatrical side of things?
I think it's safer on TV because TV, you know, takes more time to develop. Sure, it could go also wrong like it did the end of Game of Thrones, but I think it's safer on TV because the issue with Disney, I think they got like too pride from say, hey, you know, we can make every single Star Wars movie once a year. No, because before that, it takes like 3 years to make a Star Wars movie. Look what happened with Solo. So many production
and Solo,
issues.
And Solo. Well, apart from the issues that it had in production, to me, Solo isn't horrible. It is a good space adventure film. And I admire Alden Ehrenreich trying to be Han Solo. But the odds were against him on that movie, and the odds were against with that movie in every single line, because you were opening up after Infinity War and Deadpool performing as well.
It was
dead on arrival. That film was dead on arrival. They should have put it on December. Yes, they had Mary Poppins and they had it and they had Aquaman, but I think it would have fared better in December than in the time that they were putting the movie in.
And, you know, publishing also 5 months after the last year, which divided many fans, like, no, dude, no, don't do that.
Yeah.
That was a big way too cocky. And it didn't even make $500 million at the box office.
Yeah. And the thing is, Star Wars is, every time there's a Star Wars movie, everyone sees it as a special event, something you cannot miss. Trying to make it a yearly thing, regardless if it is a Skywalker saga film or another story, it takes away from the spectacle side of things. Because again, The Rise of Skywalker was delayed. It was supposed to come in, I think, May of 2019, and it went on to come out in December.
Yeah,
and
all the movies were really gonna come out in May, that they were pushed to December, which I think was a good thing because then you had time to, like, you know, edit, post-production.
Yeah, well, they should have taken more time with The Rise of Skywalker, but it happened. And
yeah.
Star Wars, as you can see in the movies, in the box office side of things, except for Solo, they all made over $1 billion. So Star Wars isn't dead. By a long
no,
shot.
Of course not.
Now, Kathleen Kennedy, she is a wonderful producer. So there's no denying that. But do you think it's time for her to just take into production and bring in someone like a Kevin Feige to carry on with the narrative direction of the Star Wars franchise?
Yeah, I think someone needs to maintain and hold it. You know, try to direct this in a much more safer future,
mm-hmm.
I would say.
Everyone keeps throwing the name of Kevin Feige as the next creative producer in the Star Wars franchise. He has Marvel. He will not go away from Marvel. He has the TV production of Marvel now. So he has his hands full. They often said Jon Favreau, he is an artist, because directors are artists. And I doubt so much that Jon Favreau will stick with Star Wars for, let's say, 10 years in developing and creating new story for a Star Wars franchise. Now, Dave Filoni, being the head of Star Wars in creative, I think that's a good position for him. Now, whether he's ready for that kind of pressure or not, We don't know for sure. Now, there's a new movie coming up in 2022. Apparently, they're going to reveal soon the next director of the next film of Star Wars. Just to end things up with a speculation, who do you think should direct the High Republic films?
For me, because, you know, this is a director that has made the impossible to the possible, Christopher Nolan.
Christopher Nolan. That would...
I think he's a great director.
Yeah. I'm gonna go with the most controversial decision. I'm gonna say Rian Johnson. Again, I admire what he tried to do with the Last Jedi. It's my favorite of the new trilogy. We've seen Knives Out, successful. He's even thinking of making more movies with Daniel Craig, and Daniel Craig is up for it. So as you can see, the cast on The Rise of Skywalker, they tried to throw Ryan under the bus a little bit, but as you can see, top talent like Daniel Craig wants to work with this guy. I mean, this kind of talent wants to work with Ryan. I think it would be great to bring in that talent to the Star Wars universe. Someone like a Daniel Craig. He had a cameo in the films, but we can bring him back. People like, let's say, Toni Collette in the Star Wars universe. That would be fantastic.
Yeah.
So my choice is Ryan. So stop crying about it. Move on. Let's give him a chance again.
Now, let put the song Let It Go from Frozen.
Just like the great Kylo Ren will say, let the past die, kill it if you have to. So, finishing things up, thank you so much for being here, Luis. Again, with this little flub that we had along the way doing this show. And hopefully we'll bring you back for another special. Maybe the Oscars next year. Who knows? We'll see.
Oh, yes.
Thank you. You can follow him on Instagram and you can follow him on Facebook. You can follow me on all of the Beyond Stuff social medias. And you can follow me, as you can see, in my new Twitter, It's The One Nerd. And check out my brand new show, The Weekly Wrap, here on the Beyond Stuff channel. This is Bryan Chevrolet, and I will see you guys next time. And, may the Force be with you.
Always. May the Force be with you.